We've also been doing work with ISDC for a lot of years, and a lot of it relates to components of efficiency performance contracting. I'm going to really focus on just the last material that we've been focusing on. But I'll begin with a little bit of background. The work on efficiency performance contracting comes from our previous work on chemical supply management or chemical management services. And what makes it unique is the financial arrangement between the supplier of chemicals and the user of chemicals. So let me just take a moment to explain that, and then I think efficiency performance contracting will make more sense. In a traditional chemical supply program, if you're the chemical supplier, this is the way you look at the supply arrangement. That you get paid per gallon. So the more gallons you supply, the more revenue you get. So your sales revenue line increases with volume. Of course, your costs go up. You've got to make that product. But it goes up more slowly than your revenue line does. So if you want to maximize profit, you want to maximize volume. So as you're servicing an account, your number one goal is increase volume. At least keep volume where it is or increase it if possible. Well, that works against the interests of the chemical user. If the chemical user wants to save money, wants to reduce environmental impact, they want to minimize the chemical volume. And so you're working at cross purposes. And a key thing to keep in mind is who's got the greatest chemical expertise? It's the supplier, usually not the user, who might be a metalworking shop, for example. So the people who have the greatest knowledge about how to reduce chemicals are operating under a system where they're at a financial advantage to increase the amount of chemicals. So it's not surprising that a lot of chemical users have a hard time reducing chemical volume. If you change that to what's typical in a chemical management service program, it changes the financial arrangement. This again is from the perspective of the chemical supplier. Here your revenue is fixed. It's independent of chemical volume. One way to think about it is you just get a fixed revenue for a certain amount that the factory is able to produce. You agree for that revenue to supply the chemical needs of the factory, and you get your fixed revenue. Now, you can change chemical volume, your revenue stays the same. Your costs, though, continue to go up the more chemicals you provide to that plant. So it's in your financial best interest as the supplier to minimize chemical volume. Now you apply your chemical expertise to improving efficiency within the plant and reducing the volume it takes to meet the needs of that plant. This is the essence of chemical management services. This approach works very, very well for large chemical users. Large plants that are buying $1 million, $2 million, $3 million worth of chemicals a year, they switch to chemical management services. You generally see an improvement in quality in the product and in the chemical performance, and a decrease in chemical volume and chemical costs. It works very well. So that's been pretty well established over the last 15 years. Our question was, can this work for smaller facilities that have a smaller chemical volume? So, I also mentioned this previously, got a slide on it. A key thing here is core competence, that the chemical user really isn't the chemical expert. It's the chemical supplier that does. So you want the right incentive, and you want the people with the core competence of chemistry applying that knowledge. So can we make this work for small and medium enterprises, smaller businesses? Well, we looked at, for small manufacturing facilities in central Illinois, what's their typical spend in areas outside their sort of their core expertise? So we're not looking at their spend on labor or their spend on metal. or their spend on rough parts that they might bring in. We're looking at their spend in non-core areas. And in particular, we were initially interested in chemicals. Well, you can see that their spend on chemicals, you know, if their whole spend is maybe $1 million, all these areas, chemicals is a small part of that. And much too small a part to support a chemical management service program. The supplier is not going to be interested in developing this program when the revenue potential is so small. So the next thing we got thinking of is, could we use some of these other areas that the spend is a little bit bigger to drive improvements in chemicals and maybe in some of the other areas? So could we begin to group together some of these so you have multiple spends grouped under one contract? And it might look something like this. So we've got the small, medium enterprise here. This is to represent suppliers that we find one anchor area, kind of a core area that would financially support the contract, but then begin to bring in some of these other non-core areas through supplier alliances. So let me just give you a couple examples that we explore. One is tooling. Tooling is a big spend for metalworking facilities. Could you develop a tooling management program, sort of like chemical management, and then slowly add other areas to it, particularly chemicals and especially metalworking tools? So perhaps it starts as a tooling management program, but you begin to include metalworking fluids in that program as well, so that you know, your manager from your tooling supplier might really be sort of managing the tooling management program, but they develop an alliance with a coolant provider, metalworking fluid provider, under that same contract. Another option that we looked at was paint. If it's a facility that does a lot of painting, their spend can sometimes be pretty significant. Could you develop a program that's anchored on paint and then possibly include things like natural gas? Because a lot of the natural gas use is in drying and curing of the painted product. So if you had a program focused on paint, could they begin to bring in natural gas as an additional area where they're seeing improvements? And then a third area is really just focusing on energy. Again, with large energy users, they have energy performance contracts where a supplier comes in and focuses on improving energy efficiency, basically gets a share of those savings, and you can support a program in that way. For some of the small manufacturers, their energy spend might be big enough to support some kind of program along those lines. So those were the three areas we explored. Tooling, anchor, paint as an anchor, and then energy as a program. So our research, and this was done with Dan Marsh here at ISTC, worked with the various suppliers in those areas, worked with a number of small and medium enterprises, manufacturers in Central Illinois, to try to get pilot programs started in each of those areas, if that looked feasible. So here's basically what we found, and then I'll address four plants in particular that we can get some lessons from. So what we found is that tooling management works very well. Even for these small companies, tooling management is a great approach, and they can see significant improvements in tooling performance. But, at least with the pilot programs that we were following, we couldn't get the chemicals to work successfully as part of that program. We still think it's possible, but in the pilot programs that we were looking at, it didn't work. With paint management, we couldn't get the suppliers in. And we can talk about why that is during the discussion period if you like. But paint supply is very different than tooling supply. And we think it's probably that difference in the way the supply networks are set up that you just couldn't get the paint suppliers interested in this. And then finally, energy. The existing energy management companies were not interested. This is just too small of a potential market for them. And we couldn't develop really a new supply base in the time that we had for these pilot projects. We still think, though, that the market is promising for them. So let me talk about a few example plants and the lessons that we learned from those. These are all manufacturing facilities. Plant A, 120 employees, 130,000 square feet. They make various metal products for the auto industry. Their tooling management program was very successful. In fact, let me just show you some results for their tooling management program. If you sort of take their, when they started tooling management as the benchmark of 100%, they got almost a 50% reduction in their tooling costs, which for a company to reduce your tooling costs per unit of output 50%, that's very dramatic. In addition, they saw improvements in quality over that time, so that fewer defects, faster turnaround times, better management of the tooling within the plant, and this 50% reduction in cost. Now, you might look here and say, uh-oh, we're sliding back, costs are going back up. That was a very deliberate decision by the plant to take on a new contract with a automaker to make a part that was going to require much more intense machining. And it was going to require much more expensive tools to do it. So that really represents a new product for the plant that produced that increase in their tooling costs. So they still consider their tooling management program very successful. They think the increase would have been much more than that if they had had to do it without the tooling management program. But they tried to incorporate coolants in the program and it failed. And we think the reason is the way they went about it. The supplier, their tooling supplier, had an existing partnership with a coolant provider. And so they thought, well, we already have this partnership. Let's bring that provider in and try to make their product fit into this plant. And it never fit. We think the better approach would have been the same approach they used for tooling. Say, here's what the plant does, here's what the plant needs, let's go form a relationship with a coolant provider that can meet that need. And they didn't do that. Once they backtracked, they got rid of that old supplier, their intention was to then try it that way. And we'll see whether that works. Plant B also had a very successful tooling management program. They had a lot of savings. They saw some real improvements in quality, dramatic reduction in their tooling inventory. So tooling management worked much better. But in this case, neither the supplier nor the plant could get really interested in trying to make coolant part of that program. Even though in a lot of ways they agreed it made sense, the coolants worked with the tools, and if you can match them up and run them as a system, it'll work much better. I don't know if it was just resistance to change, or if the system works so well as it is, let's not change it. We just couldn't get them to include coolants. But clearly the toolant management part was very successful. With plant C, this was a very small plant. And we thought, you know, tooling management can work here, it can work anywhere. And they got started with a tooling management program. It looked like it was really going to work well. Their initial successes were good. They had hoped for, I think, about a 10% reduction in costs in the first year. They saw about a 30% reduction in cost the first year. But then the economy turned and the plant closed. So it was unfortunate. It looked promising. We have no idea how it would have turned out. And then the fourth plant that I want to talk about was a very interesting one. Large facility for small companies that we look at. They were very interested in this tooling management, coolant management combination. They actually went to plant A and studied how they did it at plant A, but just couldn't make that final commitment. They said, we just can't go down to one tooling provider. We want to keep two. We just don't want to stop buying by the tool. So they didn't want to change that financial incentive to reward the tooling supplier for improvements. So they finally went with two suppliers. They didn't include these efficiency incentives. And as I talked with them, you know, a year or 2 years afterwards, they were not happy with the outcome. No, they said it's okay, it's better than what we had, but we really have been disappointed not seeing the improvements. So, you know, I think it was a company that wanted to go sort of halfway into tooling management, and it really didn't work that well. So we'll see whether they now take it all the way. So again, just kind of a summary, and then we can use the time to discuss any part of chemical management or tooling management that you'd like to. You know, we think the tooling management with these small companies is very successful. We think it can work with metalworking fluids and maybe some other chemicals, but we just were not able to get that done in the pilot projects. Paint management, I don't think, is going to happen unless there's a significant change in the supply relationship with small companies. But energy, especially as energy prices continue to rise, energy management, I think, for small companies will, there is a market for that. And what we really need is a supply base that doesn't exist yet that can bring those energy efficiencies to small companies. So with that, I think we're open, didn't take a lot of time, wanted to leave time for discussion, whatever way you might want to go with discussion. So are there questions?
Yeah, but I'm sort of surprised on paint management. Isn't that working for, isn't chemical supply for painting working with some large manufacturers so that there are paint suppliers that are willing to do it there? Is that there's sort of some size cutoff where they're not willing?
Yeah, I think, you know, the difference in the supply base for tooling versus paint is with small manufacturers, when they buy tooling, they'll buy from a local company that's a fairly small company, and they supply tools from all the different tool manufacturers. So that supplier is small scale, and all of their customers are small scale. And they're much more willing to work in a close relationship with a small supplier. And they're willing to buy whatever tool is needed in order to accomplish what that small manufacturer needs. The paint suppliers, on the other hand, the large paint manufacturers have direct reps that work with the small manufacturers. So they may have small companies they work with, they may have large companies they work with, and they only sell their product. They don't carry an array of paints from all different kinds of paint suppliers. So they're much less willing to say, you know, let's work on this. I'll just be kind of your paint manager. We'll get paint from wherever. I'm willing, you know, if it reduces the volume of paint, that's okay because I don't make the paint anyway. They're not willing to take on that because that's their product. They make paint and, you know, they just want to sell that paint. So I think even though some of these paint suppliers, like PPG, have these kind of relationships for the big customers. PPG's got a great program like this with Chrysler up at Belvedere, where they do paint management with them. They're just unwilling. It just doesn't work with these small customers because they're just, that's their only product at that point. At least that's the best we've been able to determine.
Is it an economic issue also for them? That's why they don't want to work?
Well, yeah, I mean, it could be that their profit needs are much better, much bigger, and that the small additional profit they might be able to get by working intensively with these companies just isn't worth it. Whereas the tooling suppliers, they are small scale, and that might be sufficient profit. That could be part of it.
Yes? I think the energy management information is really important because of the issues. And I just wanted you to tell us more about the progress in that, but also I'm thinking about even University of Illinois, also we need energy management. And we have to have a, if anyone got any pilot program even, towards like department, one building or one chemistry building, for example.
Well, there, so the question was about energy management, and that it would seem like a good market, has anybody done pilot projects? For large energy users, there are some very successful energy management programs, and particularly in what's called the MUSH market, M-U-S-H, so municipalities, universities, not that I forget that, schools, meaning grade schools, and hospitals. Now, there are a bunch of companies, Johnson Controls, Siemens, I can't think of others right now, but there's a lot of companies that service that MUSH market with energy management programs. And the big reason is that it works there is that those entities have a hard time raising capital. So if they say, you know, we want to go through and replace all the lighting, where are we going to get the money to do that? Well, these energy management companies will come in and provide that capital in return for the energy savings over the next 7 to 10 or 15 years. The same thing does not happen in manufacturing. So, for example, Caterpillar has a big plant. They might need a lot of energy improvements, but they're not going to contract with an energy service company to come in and do it because the energy service company wants the returns for like 7 to 10 years. And when Caterpillar hears 7 to 10 years, they say, no way, 2 years. 2 years I'll get it. Well, they can't make a profit with just the returns for 2 years. So the idea of taking it and making it work in small manufacturers, when I went and talked to these energy service companies, they said, no way, we're not even interested in talking to them. Because first of all, they want it in 2 years, and secondly, it's such a small market that they don't want to do it. So where we got, what we thought was most promising was a lot of the lighting suppliers. In a lot of these factories, the low-hanging fruit is lighting. They've got older, inefficient lighting, could be easily upgraded to fluorescent high-bay lighting, some very significant upfront savings. They just need the capital to make that improvement. So we brought in some lighting suppliers, but the what we were trying to get them to do is to say, let's not just stop at lighting. Let's also take a look at motors. Can you develop a motor management program? Build in air compressors and some of the other big energy users. And the lighting contractors just weren't interested. They said, not lighting is it, and then we walk away. Buy the lighting and we want out. So we talked to air compressor companies. And they'd say, no, we'll manage the air compressors, but we don't want to know anything about lighting. So we just couldn't build that critical mass of suppliers that could provide these companies with the expertise they needed. We still think a lot of that is low-tech enough, the lighting, the air compressors, the motors, that an energy consultant could handle all those things and could potentially be a partner with a company to bring in those improvements. We even found some outside capital providers who were willing to provide the capital, basically buy the lighting for the company and rent the lighting to the company so that they could see some immediate savings. But still just couldn't get that put together in the time that we had. So we still think that's a good potential market. It's going to take a while to develop. But as energy prices go up, we hope that'll accelerate the market. Okay.
Yeah, I took a look at your interesting first two slides on CMS, and I thought of the laboratory. We have these real bad incentives when from Sigma and other chemical suppliers that you only need a small amount of chemical to do your experiment, but for $2 extra you buy this big thing.
Exactly. Yes.
And years ago when I was on the our chemical safety committee, one of the big costs to the university was actually decommissioning labs because of all these huge bottles.
All the leftovers.
Are there any moves do CMS?
Yes. Yes.
Yes, the short answer.
Yeah. With chemical management services, it's most profitable and it works the best where the chemical user uses a few chemicals in large volume. Okay, it's very simple to study. It's very simple to figure out how you can make improvements. And the savings can be very substantial and can drive the whole program. It's more complicated when you have a large number of chemicals that you use in very small volume. It's hard to really study how could we improve the efficiency use of this chemical, how could we create a lot of savings. So there have been some programs for hospitals and universities and the SLAC, Stanford Linear Accelerator Laboratory, is one that really piloted this. And others have since also started. But what they realized is we cannot expect to save any money in the net. So as a whole, we're going to spend about what we spent before. But what they figured is we're going to spend a little bit more on the chemicals we buy, but we're going to really save it on waste. And that's what they found, is when they contracted with a chemical management company, they only got the volume of chemical they needed. So they could keep their inventories very low. There was very little leftovers in these labs, very little waste to get rid of. But the management of those chemicals was more expensive. So it kind of was a wash. And they sold it within the university that this is not a monetary savings, it's a liability reduction and a management improvement. The chemicals are going to be managed so much better. We're going to have less waste, less liability, and that's what sold it. And they've been happy with it.
Just so I understand, so when you said it net was, it wasn't money saving, that means you're drawing the box around everything.
Yes.
Cradle to grave.
Yes, and part of their sales internally within Stanford was, you have to look at all these costs. You can't just look at the invoice for the chemical. Invoice for the chemical might go up, but our waste disposal costs are going to go down. And because it's different parts of the university pay those bills, it was hard, you know, it's a hard sell like it is with any company. But they were able to do it. You know, the university looked at that and thought, yeah, you know, that is really going to be better for us, even though in the whole we're not going to save money. And I think anytime you're talking about a lab setting like that, you're probably not going to have that savings. Okay. Other?